Kid, I want you to meet Mr. Bernie Rose.
My husband is coming home.
Where is he?
He's in prison.
There's some guys that want me to do a job for him, and I'm not gonna do it.
What's the job? Did you have any idea there'd be a second car? Whose money do I have?
You should have taken the money and left the guy alone.
They're gonna come looking for me, and they're gonna come for you. Do you understand? You gotta get out of here, and you gotta get out now.
What are you gonna do?
You give me a time and a place, I give you a 5-minute window. Anything happens in that 5 minutes and I'm yours, no matter what.
The first time I read the novel, it was such a sort of rare book to get sent, you know, from a studio, because it was very short, it was very dark, it was almost more like a poem, and it had this very, very tiny subplot of getaway driver getting involved in a bank robbery that gets, you know, goes wrong, and then the mafia coming after him, but that was a tiny part of it. There was so much more character stuff around that.
He has a lot invested in you, and so do I. So anything you need, you call me. We're a team now.
What was exciting was to be able to sort of have the space in a screenplay to sort of explore the characters and take these wonderful characters that he'd created and sort of invent subplots and relationships, you know, between characters that were not in the book.
Chopsticks and a fortune cookie. Put out the fucking cigarette, I'm eating.
We were very fortunate just to attract a fantastic, fantastic cast. So everywhere you turn, there's a compelling character, and they're all acting with a consistent tone, thanks to the direction of Nicholas, and they feel like people inhabiting a world, sort of a part of Los Angeles perhaps we haven't seen or don't know, but it feels vivid and real.
Mostly I work at a garage.
Where?
Reseda Boulevard.
I like that he wasn't ambitious. I like that he didn't have a goal, because so many movie heroes have to have a goal and an idea of where they want to end up and a dream and an ambition. And we toyed with that, but I ended up loving the fact that he doesn't have any of those things. The people around him, all these other characters, have an idea of where they want to be, but he doesn't. He sort of lives and breathes, you know, it's by the second, and there's no game plan, there's no long term. It's all those sort of, you know, things about his character sort of make him a very good center, I think, for the, you know, for everyone else almost to sort of revolve around.
Hey, there you are. She's down there.
When I first read Drive, the role of Shannon was almost like Burgess Meredith in Rocky, you know. Come on, Rock, you can do it, come on, kid, you know. And while there's still some of that element of mentor-protege relationship with my character and the driver, Nicholas was amazing in his collaboration. In fact, insisted on it, make it your own. And because of that openness, you go home and you start daydreaming about the character, and I'd wake up in the morning and I'd go, oh, I have a couple more ideas I want to pitch. And so I was pitching to him different thoughts and ideas, and they stuck, and he was welcoming them.
Shannon, sell him the car.
He wouldn't be able to find pussy in a whorehouse.
So he has some big dreams, and some are realized, but it's not enough. He's always, you know, tinkering and thinking, what's his next move? And he talks too much.
So I hire him on the spot. Boom. At about half the wages I normally pay. He didn't blink an eye. And I have been exploiting him ever since.
He just kind of yaps a lot, which is a nice contrast to Driver's mostly silent approach to things.
So I offered your services to take Benicio and Irene home. That'd be okay?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
When we were working on the screenplay, we never imagined Carey Mulligan would play the role of Irene. Carey was a big fan of our directors, Nicholas Winding Refn, and she called up and she said, I want to talk to him about why I think I should be in this film. And when Nicholas sat down with her, he absolutely knew, and it really reshaped the film.
I wanted to work with someone like Nicholas Winding Refn, and also the idea of working with Ryan that made me kind of go after it, because the original script was written for sort of a Latina woman, she was slightly older, so it sort of meant in going in sort of bargaining to have it rewritten.
Sorry if I put you on the spot showing up like that.
in pre-production, I spent 2 or 3 days with Huss, and we went through the script and figured out where she came from, what she did, how long she'd been with Standard. My whole backstory, really, I did with Huss. And that was really what we had to do. We had to change her from this Latina woman, and that sort of, you know, the culture of the whole family was very different. And so we had to rewrite that, and so that she could be a bit younger and figure out how that all happened and what that was like being married at, like, 17. And then started, you know, bringing other characters into the conversation.
You know, we're here celebrating, but it's a shameful thing, what I did. And I have a lot of making up to do to everyone.
When I sat and talked with Nicholas, he really kind of painted the whole picture for me. I had read the script and I thought it was really cool, it was interesting, but I did have a lot of questions about it, particularly with my character. You know, things weren't quite as specific as maybe I'd hoped they would be. And as soon as I sat down with Nicholas, he just explained to me the universe and the world of it, and actually left a lot of it up to me.
The fuck are you gonna do? You gonna go beat him up for me? My stunt guy? Why the fuck do you wanna know who they are?
Oscar came in and literally blew everybody away. Nobody, because you know, I'd never worked with Oscar, and I didn't know, you know, this character was sort of not the guy really on the page that you really care that much about. You know, he gets into trouble and then he goes away, and you sort of accept it. But Oscar came in and started playing Standard, and you feel so much empathy for him.
Because I owed some protection money from when I was inside. It was $2,000, and as soon as I got out. Oh, it's $5,000. Oh no, actually it's $10,000, $20,000. Tomorrow, I don't know what the fuck it's gonna be.
Then we started talking about it. What if he's someone that just made some wrong decisions in his life and ended up in a bad place? And we ended up finding that story much more compelling. It's definitely been one of the most collaborative experiences I've ever had on a film.
I can't do this thing alone.
You got Blanche.
Come on, man.
She's beautiful, look at her.
I would say this is different from what I've been doing all year long, and a fun character just to do something completely different. And I just thought it was a fantastic script.
You know what? Get the fuck out of here. Get up. Standard, take her with you and go get her a fucking Coke.
He said there would be another car to hold us up. But he didn't say anything about all this money. He didn't say anything about anyone getting killed.
Her involvement with these guys wasn't even supposed to truly happen. And the next thing you know, I mean, everything's gone wrong, and here she is with Driver and much more involved than she ever thought she would be.
The whole notion of the heist that goes wrong was, I mean, you've seen it in lots of movies, but what was interesting about it in the book was certainly the way we developed the script with Mark and Adam as well, before anyone even came on, was how does it affect all the different characters? And it was one of those heists gone wrong that seemed to have, you know, lots of offshoots. So everyone is affected. So you introduce these characters in the first sort of act, and then the heist doesn't just affect Driver. Everyone is suddenly brought in together and into this sort of explosion, and it's just a very simple mess up. Really has these huge repercussions.
So you stole from the East Coast mob.
No, I stole from some jumped up punk. Was trying to step on our action.
Yeah? Then why didn't you come to me before you set up this dummy robbery?
He's not a villain. It's a guy who's spent his life dealing in legal to illegal situations, depending on how he wants to make his money. But he's pushed into a corner in this movie.
You know, I owe you this guy. Just give me a little time and I'll get rid of him.
Shut the fuck up, you fucking monkey.
When push comes to shove, it's his life or someone else's. So he's reacting like a caged animal. He doesn't act like this all the time, but you don't want to mess with him.
Don't worry. Don't worry. That's it. It's done.
It gives me something that I never played before, which is a guy you really don't want to fool around with. And it gives me a chance to find a look, and let's just say I've never killed anyone in a movie before.
You pay 300 fucking grand for this piece of shit?
I was like a huge fan of his from the moment the world discovered him. So to work with Albert is hard to put into words. What a treat that is.
It's the inside that counts, not the outside. Right, Shannon?
You are correct, sir.
Fuck that shit. I pay 300 for something. I want everybody to fucking see it.
Of course you do.
They sort of have always been in business together. They remind me of George and Lenny and of Mice and Men.
I'm gonna tell you something. Anybody finds out you stole from the family, we're both dead.
I was so thrilled that, you know, Ron and Albert were sort of interested, and then again, sitting down with them to go over the script, they improved their parts just enormously, because, you know, they're both brilliant actors.
Yeah, I'm 59 years old, Bernie. They still pinch my cheek like I'm some fucking kid.
When I first was given the script, one never quite knew who he was, where he came from, what he did. And Nicholas was determined to put some flesh on the bones and to give this guy a past.
I'm just fucking with you. How you doing, Shannon? How's the fucking leg?
Little by little, Nino got more discovered and took a more prominent place in the storytelling and became easier to play.
That's why this driver's gotta go, Bernie. He's gotta go.
What do you say we meet?
Why?
Well, you, me, and your girlfriend are the only players left. How's that for a reason?
This is one of the things, if you do a movie, you get thrown in a pot with all these other actors. I equate it to like a great tennis game. These are just the people who are among the best in their field. So it makes you better. You hit the ball as hard as you can, they hit it back.
Here's what I'm prepared to offer. You give me the money, the girl is safe. Forever, nobody knows about her. She's off the map.
It's been great fun for me because each actor kind of realizes that their character needs their own story. And sometimes when you're writing, the plot becomes important, or, you know, certain characters are there purely to serve a function. And then when you sort of trust the actors and the director, I think, you know, they just make you look good if it works.
Any dreams you have or plans or hopes for your future, I think you're gonna have to put that on hold. For the rest of your life, you're gonna be looking over your shoulder.